Hey, I'm Scott Giroux, and welcome to another episode of Power Apps Cafe. I was doing some ribbon editing using the Ribbon Workbench app, and I noticed a new button that I hadn't seen before. It had a Power BI logo, so I did a little bit of digging, and I found this new feature that's literally only just been included in the docs. I thought I'd share it with you. Check it out. So if we look at the blog post, it talks about visualizing your data quickly from Power Apps and Dynamics 365 apps. It's a preview feature and it's just literally just been included in the docs. Now, I haven't seen this actually in any of the announcements around Ignite or recently. It's certainly not been included in the Power BI blog or the Power Apps blog recently. So it's kind of slipped in there under the radar. You may have seen it announced somewhere else. But the idea, by the looks of it, is that it's including a Power BI dashboard automatically from a view inside your Power App. Now, we've had the ability to embed Power Apps inside a dashboard for a long time in Power Apps. Fairly recently, we could include those as system Power BI dashboards. But the thing is that, you know, you had to go and set it up, right? You had to go and create the Power BI report. You had to go and connect everything. You have to include it. So there was quite a lot of work that you had to do it. So the key word, I think, on this is quickly. Now, obviously, we've got show charts. You know, charts have been a key part of Power Apps for a very long time, and they're still very, very powerful, you know, really quick, allowing you to drill in to a certain records. You know, you can create lots of different styles. You know, you can create your bar graphs, your line graphs, loads of different things. So I think, I'm a big fan of the kind of the built-in charting, but Power BI has got so many really neat features in there. You know, it's really fast, snappy, easy to drill down. You can bring in a lot of complex visualization. So Power BI is really alluring, and this has been the challenge. It's been, okay, well, in order to get Power BI set up, you've got to have a separate license. You have to configure it and then go and add it into your solution. But this new button here, visualize this view, which is the thing that popped up. Now, if you go over into the blog post, it talks about going into your settings to enable it. If we go right down to the bottom here, you can see here that there's this enable Power BI quick report visualization preview. And so once you've done that, you get this new button. So if I click this button, what it's doing is on the fly, it's going and creating me a Power BI report and dashboard using the view that I currently have. So if I've got a custom view, if I've got a system views, whatever's defined in that view, I can go and add in any custom data that I've got in columns, and it just brings it in. And so you can see it's fairly quick, actually. You know, I didn't, that was no smoke and mirrors. That was the speed that it actually generates it at. Now, and on the right-hand side here, we can obviously go and select different fields that we want to bring in, so we can go and add additional data, which is pretty cool. And what it seems to do is it seems to sort of make a decision based on the fields that you've got selected. It's just automatically deciding on what best way to visualize the data that you've selected. And of course, once I've got this is a standard a dashboard from Power BI. So I can sort of select, okay, all the hot opportunities, and it kind of goes and shows me a filter and, you know, all the really nice stuff that you get with Power BI. I can also say show data table. So this is the thing that really struck me initially, is unlike the charts inside Power Apps with the aggregation that goes on, what it looks like here is we've actually got all of the data loaded into this Power BI dashboard, which means I can actually go and, so I say, if I select hot again, I can go and see all of the hot opportunities in this table at the bottom. And I can even go and select any one of those, and then it will filter and show me that particular opportunity in the top half. So you can see, you immediately get all of that cool stuff. Obviously, I could go into any of these charts and I can actually say, well, actually, I don't want a clustered bar chart. You know, show me this as a pie chart, for example. you know, so immediately I got this customization ability. But the one thing that in this preview stage, and one of the caveats it says, is that I can't save this. If I go and change any of these elements and I move away from this page, or I think at the moment the timeout is an hour, it's kind of lost forever. So it's about speed and ease of creating something that immediately gets me drilling into my data, rather than having to go and get someone to go and set up a Power BI report for me and adding it in. But this kind of got me thinking, is that, okay, so if it's loading in all of this data into my Power BI report that I just generated, well, what happens about in the scenarios that, if you've ever created any charts built into Power Apps, you'll know potentially about this limitation that there is. So I've got more than 50,000 accounts loaded in. I just kind of generated some dummy data here. And you can see that we're actually getting an error from this particular chart, because it's effectively trying to aggregate across more than 50,000 records. But I was thinking, okay, well, so how is it actually working here? Now, firstly, I wanted to know, well, is it running a aggregate report? But evidently it's not running an aggregate report, because I can actually click on that table and I can get all of the individual accounts. But also, how is it actually getting that data? So one of the things I tried to do quickly was I went into my admin center and I turned off this TDS endpoint, because if you've written any Power BI reports connecting to Power Apps Dataverse, Microsoft Dataverse, you'll know that there is this direct query option now, and that uses this TDS endpoint. So firstly, I wanted to decide on how is it actually querying. Is it using the web API or is it using the TDS? So I turned this off, and lo and behold, when I went and did a query, it didn't work. It didn't even give me an error. I looked at the behind the scenes and actually was saying TDS endpoint not enabled in sort of under the hood, but there was no visual user interface error. It's a preview feature, so I guess they'll work on that. But if I come back here, you can see here that it's certainly taking a lot longer than it was with the opportunities, because what it's doing is it's actually downloading all of the accounts into this Power BI report. And Power BI is actually very, very efficient with its calculation engine, aggregation engine. It loads in the raw data, and then it kind of creates this big cached model of all of the various different measures that you're going to be using. But it wasn't, you know, that wasn't that slow. I mean, this is loading, I think, 65,000 records. It didn't take that long. Obviously, it's a lot of these records are quite simple. They've just got account name, and you know that probably will go up gradually. But the thing is, the key point here is that you can see the aggregation, right? So we're actually aggregating across all of these different records, and I can go and bring in other bits of data and start to do counts across more than my 50,000 records, which is always a limitation. And the great thing is that, you know, it's just a click of a button away, and I don't have to even go and define any charts. So another really cool feature I think makes this really easy to use as well is, I mean, if you've used Wave 2, you'll know that I can easily add in additional fields into my view. So if I go and add my related account for these opportunities, the city, so I can add that in and apply that. So now I've got all my opportunities with the city. So if I click on visualize this view, I don't even have to save that view. I mean, it's literally just transient. And what Power BI, this visualization doing, is it's actually picking that up directly from my view, unloading all that data in. So there it's loaded up. And now we've got this rather perplexing big long value here, A47B is a big GUID. But this is one of the limitations that's called out in the docs article, is that the relationships don't get friendly names. And in fact, a lot of these, all these fields here, what you're seeing is the schema name. So it's preview, they'll work on that. But the point is that I've got that related record data. So now I can see all of my opportunities by the city of the account. So if I want to say, okay, well, what opportunities I have in Dallas, I can select that, and you can see here, okay, well, we've got 12 million won, 7 million lost, zero open. So, you know, immediately you've got this ability to start doing that self-service BI. Self-service BI was a bit of a buzzword that came up a long time ago when Power BI first was becoming popular. But the self-service BI really sort of relied on somebody setting it up for you to get to that point of self-service. But what this does is it really does get to this point of truly self-service BI, because this feature is actually using the data model, the metadata of our system, to decide on how best to actually show this data, so I can start to drill into this and start to investigate my data. So I hope you agree that this is a really exciting feature. It's obviously preview, as I said, so we'll have to watch this space. I've no idea what the licensing implications are or what the roadmap is, but I think that it really does have significant promise because of that quick ease of getting to all of that goodness that we know and love from Power BI. If you'd like to hear more from me about new features in Power Apps, do subscribe. But until next time, take care. Cheers.